Can you all hear me? Okay. This is going to be a very dynamic session. Welcome to TAYtalks Live, Innovation Education. So happy to see everyone here today. This is a totally unscripted, unrehearsed session. So they have no idea what I'm going to ask. Sometimes I don't even know what I'm going to ask, but we're going to have a lively conversation about innovation and transformation at the agency, at NASA, at Duke Energy and the industry, and we want your participation in the audience as well. So we also have some swag. We've got mugs, t-shirts, tote bags, which, Christine, there we go. We got some tote bags too. So if you participate live in the audience, you get some swag. How's that sound? Pretty good? All right, good, good. We want this to be a lively conversation. So my name is Taylor Lamb. I'm a senior project manager in the new reactors licensing branch. A couple of things that I need to start the session off with is that we're going to have a QR code. And my sound went out. Okay, we're going to have a QR code that's posted for you to ask questions. And Niamh is going to hand me the tablet so that way she can pass me off the questions. And then you can also write down your questions on paper, which we have right over there. So with that being said, why don't we introduce ourselves? Scott, you want to start?
Sure. Can you hear me okay?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I'm Scott Morris. I'm your brand new NRC Deputy Executive Director for Operations of the Reactor and Preparedness Programs. Just started about a month and a half ago. But primarily, I was the regional administrator out in Region 4 for about 4.5 years, and I've been in the agency now 30-plus years, and I think I've worked in two different regions and headquarters, about half my time in the regions, half my time in headquarters, and looking forward to today's lively discussion.
Yeah, Scott's actually pretty good at making things up on the fly, so we're excited about that.
That's cheating.
You have notes.
What's
with the notes?
Key points I want to make sure get part of the conversation. But if they do,
all right. I guess we'll take that. All right, Katie.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Katie.
Mike.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Katie McCurry. I'm currently serving as the director of Embark, which is a small innovation catalyst located in our Office of Nuclear Reactor Regulation. My permanent role is the technical assistant of Region 2.
Do you have a fun fact about yourself?
Really?
Scott's fun.
Ask me about it.
Well, Scott's fun fact is that you make stuff up on the go. You're really good at that.
We'll see.
Make sure you speak into the mic though, because I just got a text message that people can't hear online.
My fun fact. I was really hoping you'd forget.
I got more fun facts if you want me to take them.
So my fun fact is that I learned about the NRC from a Georgia Tech football game. I ran into some people, and that is how I got recruited. So maybe we should look into that for recruitment.
That is a way less fun fact than the avocado fun fact that you had.
I'm going with the avocado one, okay?
Yeah, avocados are way better than hearing about Georgia Tech, okay. All right, so we also have Sean Gibby here with us today.
Yeah, I'm Sean Gibby. I'm the Vice President of Engineering for Duke Energy Nuclear. Been with the company 33 years, worked for Westinghouse and DuPont before that. Fun fact, I'm glad you asked her first so I could think about it. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. I'm not going to repeat that if you missed it. But the safest fun fact I have is my third and last child, Mallory, was 12 pounds, 3 ounces when she was
born. Oh, wow.
And that was the end of that.
Wow. I don't know if that's fun. It's interesting, that's for sure. All right, and Christine.
Yeah, Christine Jenkins. I'm Director of Civil Programs for Stellar Solutions, which probably a company you've never heard of. It's a small, women-owned, pretty much system engineering company. And as a revenue-generating unit in that company, I work for NASA, the Johnson Space Center, where it's the Center of Excellence for Collaborative Innovation. And as that, in that role, I'm the lead for our federal government work. So we do a lot of open innovation, crowdsourcing, freelance talent work, and we make our contracts available to anyone in the federal government who has an interest in trying them out, like NRC has done. Fun fact, I was going to say I'm a Nittany Lion, like somebody else on this panel. We are!
We are!
All right.
Come on.
There's always a few. I love it. I'm also a first-generation Italian and Ukrainian-American.
Oh, wow.
That is very interesting, actually. And when we were talking last week, so we did, you know, we did do a kind of like a prep session last week where we just talked about generally how we're going to wing it. But they did find out that they went to school together and graduated in the same year and had no idea
in
the same program, electrical engineering. So I thought that was really interesting, and Scott's comments were particularly interesting, but I'm not going to repeat those here.
It was one of the most interesting comments I've ever had in a professional meeting.
Had to be there.
We'll leave it at that.
You gotta tell them now.
All right, so make sure that if you have any questions, you write them down, use the QR code that we have posted up here, or if you see it online, we'll have that. Why don't we get the first polling question up for the day? So we do have polling questions, and if you're virtual, there should be an option for polling questions on the right-hand side of the screen, and you can respond there. All right, in the meantime, I don't know, I guess I'm gonna ask some questions. I kind of have some notes written down, but why don't you tell me a little bit about your individual innovation groups that you run. You could go in any order. We're not here to.
Okay, I can go.
Yeah, go ahead, Christine.
Since I work in a innovation group, which is a very small, tiny but mighty group.
Tiny but mighty.
And we've done over 700 crowdsourcing and freelance projects so far. I've been doing this for about 6 years. There was about eight of us on the team. And our projects range anywhere from, maybe you have a specific skill type you need and your team just doesn't have that person. And you want to develop and get some freelance talent to satisfy that need. We do that all the way up to multi-million dollar crowdsourcing competitions. My biggest one right now is about $30 million, and that's for the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency. I also have several multi-million dollar projects for National Institutes of Health and Health and Human Services. Things as varied as, find me data to feed the world magnetic model so all of our GPS systems work and our cell phones and Christine doesn't get lost like she's directionally challenged and needs it, to we need a diagnostic test for Lyme disease. And apparently we don't have one right now.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, so we also at the agency work with NASA for our crowdsourcing. So Audrey Thomas, who is the hype woman in the audience, you can take a look at her over there, she's waving. She is actually in charge of innovation at the NRC, and then also we have Niav Green, who is, a huge proponent of innovation at the agency and works on it as well. But we did work with NASA to develop our crowdsourcing abilities. All right, who's going up next? Out of order. Come on, Katie.
All right, so like I said, so I'm the director of Embark Venture Studio. We started in 2019. Again, we're in the Office of New Nuclear Reactor Regulation, but we're really an agency-wide resource. We're an innovation catalyst. We're trying to remove barriers to innovation, challenge the status quo. Our logo is actually a paper airplane because the concept was, make one, if it doesn't fly, crumple it up, we can try again. And so we're really trying to take, small steps to change because that then you can create a much bigger picture. So we're really focused on data and improving the use, the accuracy, the visualization of data, and helping to improve our processes with that, and just the knowledge, and make more risk-informed decisions.
And I really like how you brought up the idea of crumpling the paper airplane, because when you're working on innovation and transformation activities, there is failure. It's inevitable. You know, sometimes your ideas are just not going to get through, but you have to make sure that you push and move on and recreate that paper airplane. Sean, why don't
you go next? So for Duke Energy, we have an enterprise team formed, you know, the keywords of human-centric design thinking and agile environment. And so when you walk over to Optimus Hall, it feels more like you're walking into a Google facility than a regular utility facility. And so that's the enterprise level. So for nuclear, we created an innovation team that interfaces with the enterprise level, and we call it FIAT, the Fleet Innovation Team. Not that we're that creative. but the things we're focused on are like, you know, how do we make our plants more safe, reliable, and cost-effective? And things like electronic work execution. So having iPads that now maintenance operations, all the procedures, work instructions, clearances, everything is on an iPad. Robots, so going into areas of the plant in a walk-in robot called Spot, you may have seen other places, rovers, things like drones. So we don't have to dive. We don't have to go inspect places in our nuclear facility and take does and take people. We can take that technology. And then we've had several efforts with innovation teams and like crowdsourcing and getting ideas that we can then work on. And the key, like others have talked about, is being agile, that you work and you get close to a product, you get people using it. And then either you decide you're going to not do it, or you're going to, you know, keep working on it to continue to improve it.
So if you're not familiar with the agile process, it's an iterative process where you keep building upon a usable product. So we've previously used the analogy of, you know, like creating a skateboard, making it into a scooter, making it into, four-wheeler, and then eventually building it into a car. And that's the agile process, is that you have an iterative process of just, you know, creating something that's usable. Mm-hmm. And Scott, you're up last.
So for the NRC as a whole, of course, we have our own overarching, in addition to Embark, an overarching program in that is Innovation 2.0, really. And it's been in place now for couple of years, but the idea is to create an infrastructure that is currently used to be housed in the EDO's office. Now it's in the Office of Research, but it's to create an infrastructure where we can collect, harvest ideas from around the agency, from any person at any level, anywhere, put them in, you know, allow them to be voted upon, or, you know, crowdsourced as to whether, you know, from a, does this make sense? Is it a good idea? Here's how you could improve the idea, and then assess that, its viability, and then ultimately try it out, right? And,
yep.
And there's an iterative process for that too. But essentially, it's just we've created an infrastructure using software and a lot of volunteers around the whole agency who are ambassadors or office leads, et cetera, to continue to promote the use of this tool, advertise it, and then recognize people or groups who come up with ideas that get implemented that are really successful. So there's a recognition piece on the back end, which we think is really important.
Yeah, so actually with that, Katie has something going on right now in the Office of Nuclear Reactor Regulation. And it's funny because this announcement ended up going out to NRR. And before I even got to the end of the announcement, I was like, this has Katie McCurry written all over it. Do you want to talk about that a little bit?
this actually did not, though, come out of Embark. Our innovation chair lead, Angela Wu, she came up with the idea. So we're using Idea Scale as the platform, but we are doing an innovation challenge, and it's March, so obviously she thought to mimic it off of March Madness, so ideas will be going head-to-head in a bracket style to compete with one another, and we'll have a final four, and then those ideas we'll definitely take to the next step and try to see if they can be implemented.
So. Yeah, and in my competitive spirit, I'm like coming up with ideas to see if I can get that time off award.
Oh, yeah.
Anytime you don't have to be at work is a good day. Andy didn't hear me for that, but
that was like,
which is probably caught out on good timing. I didn't say that. My boss in the corner, he's like, I do like working with you, Dudek, but I mean, maybe you can give me a little more time off. Cool. You gave me a thumbs up. thank you, Katie. So, really quick, this is either going to be a successful event or a major flop, which is going to be hilarious because this is a first of its kind. Ooh, we have our first question. All right, and can we put up the polling question answers, the responses? Okay. Fifth cup of coffee, but ready for the session? Fine, I'm here out of curiosity. All right, there's a big portion of you that have no idea what TAYtalks is, and I should have probably given a little description of what TAYtalks is. It kind of started with data analytics. Andrew Lurch, who's sitting in the back somewhere hiding, or he was, unless he left. He probably left early. See, he was in the first episode ever. We had TAYtalks story time with Duncan. We evolved into TAYtalks innovation education. And we're kind of testing this out right now to see if this is something that the public would be interested in hearing more about, having conversations across the agency about what we're doing. But back to what the individual organizations are doing, how do you, Sean and Christine, how do you crowdsource ideas?
Shall I go?
Yeah, you had the best answer.
I don't know about that.
I mean, is it successful?
Is it successful? Yes, we actually capture metrics on what we've done and the amount of participation we get. And we also ask when we embark on these, so I kind of got ahead of myself. So what happens is I'll work with a group like the NRC, and we will, through the Economy Act, allow them to use our contracts to hire companies that specialize in crowdsourcing. Some of them have curated communities, some of them don't, but they have really good outreach programs to get the right people involved in your competitions. And we want to know at the onset, at the very beginning, what does success look like to you at the end of this, and what would you have done had you not done a crowdsourcing competition, and how much would it have cost you? And then we compare those things, and we've got a lot of statistics and metrics that show we've had positive results like 98% of the time. It's huge. And even when you don't get a successful result, like we've done some with NASA where, you know, they asked a hard question and they didn't get any good answers. And this showed them that they had exhausted all the information that was out there and there was no good answer. So even when you fail, you're learning.
Yeah, absolutely.
Only thing I would add is, I think we call them summits, but having intentional innovation summits, inviting folks either remotely or sometimes in person to see the kind of technology and try to spur ideas. And then one more piece, it's not really the crowdsourcing piece, but when we do decide to go tackle something, is getting some of the end user, the people actually involved with the development of it and scope of it, and then, you know, trying to foster those early adopters and into our culture so that we can continue to improve.
Awesome. All right, my mic keeps going in and out. But, yeah, I just had back surgery, so you'll occasionally see me wheeling about in my wheelchair here, having a little bit of fun trying not to wheel off of the stage. No, I'm good. Well, I'll take my chances. So the first question that we have is, how does the NRC innovation program include employee engagement, keeping staff engaged? And I think that's a really great question because sometimes there is really like innovation and transformation overload. Yep. And
and innovation can almost, everybody's talking about it, it's almost become a buzzword. And so I like, first of all, I wanted to just say, I think innovation is
for me, in practical terms, right, and then I'll talk about the engagement piece, but in practical terms, it's getting ideas and turning them into action, right? And,
yep.
And there's a lot of reasons necessity is the mother of invention, so sometimes you're just, something lands on you and you have to innovate, otherwise you'll never get it done. Sometimes it's incremental, like some of the things that Katie's talking about. And all the staff in the whole organization in NRC, we've been talking really actively since 2000, and when did we have the first jam? 2018?
2019.
We had what was called a futures jam, which was basically the whole day, the agency took the day, and we just talked to each other, and people raised ideas, and and people commented on them, and it was really energizing and engaging. It was really the first opportunity that I can remember in my 30 years where you actually had the whole entire staff, including some commissioners, you know, all the way down to, you know, entry-level folks, you know, plugged in together having conversations in real time. And lots of really interesting, good ideas came out of it, and it was really engaging, and we have really leveraged that that event in terms of developing this infrastructure that I talked about, which again, we actively promote it. Again, where there's recognition on the end of it, so that when things actually are successfully implemented, we're sharing with folks, you know, look, this idea came from over here, we implemented it over here, and you know, look at the difference it made, and just continue to promote the successes. That, I think, has really helped to build engagement. It's been fun to watch. Obviously, it's a cultural challenge as we, you know, it's just a different way of operating than we have traditionally done in our history as the NRC, but it's really, it's fun and it's engaging. I don't know, I might need a new battery.
All three of us can share this one.
All three of us. Okay, now it's working. But if I can be real here for a moment, 2019, that was 4 years ago that we did this, and the environment has changed so much in that time between, you know, the public health emergency and telework and, I mean, just the way that we're going to be doing business moving forward. Do we plan on doing another jam or having some more crowdsourcing?
The short answer is yes, and I think it's been scheduled. So we're going to do a futures jam.
Who's to me?
2.0. So.
That was great.
That was a hanging curveball. Like,
oh, I like that one.
I was talking about. Yeah, we're doing another one. There's going to be much more in the way for NRC staff for you to learn more about it and figure out, you know, just put that on your calendars and think about the ideas you want to bring to the table during that event. So really looking forward to it.
Yeah, I'm getting text messages from family members here. I definitely signed up a few members. Shout out to my 93-year-old grandfather, Al, who's on the line. Yep. All right, Grandpa, you just got a clap.
But going back to the question for engagement, communicating the success is important, but also the why. Why are we changing?
Microphone.
Sorry. Why are we changing is really important to get out to the staff. It's not change just for the sake of change, and I think we need to be better about that.
Yeah, so what do you all do for, you know, in maintaining engagement at your organizations? Is it constant or?
Yeah, so we have something we call NASA at Work, which is our internal crowdsourcing program, which I believe is what you all based the internal NRC idea scale platform off of. And so in that case, sometimes people in the agency will approach us and say, well, we want to find out this solution for, I don't know, the solar wind. We will do kind of a survey internally because you'd be surprised, maybe not surprised, but each NASA center operates somewhat independently, and there could be someone at one NASA center who's already solved your problem or has your answer and you had no idea they existed. So that's one way for us to bring each other together. The other thing that NASA does is the Science Technology Directorate will put out, I think it's $300,000 every year. And we make that open through NASA at Work. We say, hey, there's money here to be had. If you want to try working in this world of crowdsourcing or freelance talent or technology surveys. And then they submit their ideas and their short proposals, and our team evaluates them. And then we actually go out and do competitions for them.
For us, it's I think it's constant communication. So you have to constantly be looking for ways to innovate, encouraging people to innovate, showing people the type of technology or opportunities we've already kind of figured out. We have a vision, mission, and strategy statements. And so last year we changed, and one of our strategies is transform. And so we lay out a culture of that everybody's looking for ways to innovate and transform. And I like the practical
microphone.
Sorry. I like the practical part of that for us as a nuclear fleet, we're going to figure out innovative ways to make our plants more safe, reliable, and cost-effective through mid-century operation. So, that focus people can really kind of, get into, feel an engagement with. And then the communication piece is really making sure we have regular update meetings, so weekly updates through either various types of communication. I think that's the best way to foster engagement.
Yeah. I think ultimately we could probably be doing better as an agency when it comes to engagement and keeping folks, energized for change, because change is inevitable. It's like death and taxes, right? Everything's going to change.
I was just going to add one more thing. How do you entice people to be a part of it, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And we talk about the 4 G's, gold, guts, glory, and good. Right, gold is more of our prize competitions. Guts is, I was brave enough to put my idea out there amongst really smart nuclear engineers, right? That's kind of guts. Glory is just getting at the top of a leaderboard or saying, I placed in this competition, right? And good is just the common good of humanity. And for our internal crowdsourcing platform, one of the things we offer is personalized autographed astronaut photos.
Okay, that's pretty cool.
Okay, so no matter what it took, I was down to win any kind of competition I could to get one.
Well,
Christine goes last.
I don't think it's as, well, I love Chair Hansen, but an autographed photo of Chair Hansen doesn't sound as exciting as
I didn't mean to brag.
That's a, dang, how do we, okay. Maybe, Commissioner Wright is pretty popular, so the mayor of the NRC. So Diane actually ended up getting the first piece of swag. Diane, you want to pick out what you'd like? Whoever submitted that question? Oh, Diane. You submitted that question, the original one, right? Do you want a tote? Do you want a mug, or do you want a T-shirt?
T-shirt,
that's right. All right, awesome. Now if I had a real talk show, there would be like an applause cheer thing going on. There we go. All right.
And I like your haircut.
Come on down.
Too.
What was that?
I like her haircut too.
Hashtag twinsies. All right, I got a really great question here. There's no name on it, but you can raise your hand and let me know who you are so you can get your swag. Innovation is great and necessary, but how do you encourage the parts of your workforce that are resistant to change to get on board without alienating them? And that's a really, really great question. At least, I'm going to answer part of that question because I like change. I like making things better. Like, we can always be doing things. Things might be working, but why not try to do them better than they already are? So obviously, you can tell I'm a little boisterous and pushy. So when I have an idea, I have a tendency to push it through. But for other folks that aren't necessarily as loud and obnoxious as I am, it might be a little bit more difficult. So first of all, who asked that question? All right, fantastic. You get a piece of swag. Would you like a mug, tote, or T-shirt? Got it. Cool. Yay! All right. So how does everybody want to answer that question? That's a tough one.
It is, and we have some experience in this because there are people who are just, they're going to be obstinate, right?
Yeah.
They don't see the value in it. You know, you're talking with a bunch of people who have spent their whole careers. How can there be someone smarter than me out there that's going to know a different way to do things? We often find that solutions come from outside your area of expertise. Like, people had nothing to do with what you're doing because they're looking at the problem differently. And we can talk to people and say, oh, you should, you must. It's not going to work. You need to tell stories. You know, stories that have evidence and results in them and that they can relate to. And then maybe they'll start trying it a little bit at a time and dip their toe in the water and go from there.
I love this. We're getting a lot of participation in the audience. I see these cards getting passed out. Yeah, free stuff, free swag, people. You can't go wrong with it.
Could I add on to what?
Please do.
So one of the things that you know, this is clearly an issue in our organization, too. I don't think
that's
a surprise. And so one of the things that, I mean, just conceptually I like to tell stories, but I also like to tell stories of successful things where, you know, we were entrenched in a certain way, and then we for various reasons, we had to change, and we did, and we were able to reflect on that and then share those stories of success to help people who might otherwise be unmotivated to change. But one of the things that, just as a conceptual model, I like to help people understand why it's important to contribute to conversations, to accept the fact that, you know, change is inevitable, and that, you know, listening to other perspectives might actually move you. And it's this idea of, I call it cone and a cube, but it's if you can envision a cone or a pylon, I should say, inside of a hollow box, but the box is opaque, and you ask three people, you poke a hole in one side of it and look in there and tell them, and you see one person's going to see a small circle, one person's going to see a triangle, one person's going to see a large circle, and what they observe in their, from their perspective is absolutely accurate and true. The problem is that it's still wrong. And it's only when they collaborate and talk together and listen to each other's perspectives and views does the whole picture come together. And I try to tell stories like that to help people, you know, really just question their own motivations and their own perspectives and to think outside the box.
I'm not sure I have a good answer, but
that's okay.
What came to mind, people are going through a lot of change. And I think all of us suffer that, and you know, just one more change, even though it's going to make your life easier, some people don't want to make that change. You know, I think about the electronic work execution. To me, it was a great idea. You know, you don't have to print out paper and go get the paper off the printer and then get all your work package organized and go out. Oh, I need a clearance. I got to come back to the office and sign into the clearance. So the thought of having an iPad that has all that available, you can just mark it up. You can do your clearance. But some people just, that's not the way they've done it for 20 years or more. So, you know, trying to get early adopters in the organization that can help influence their coworkers versus somebody's coming down to bring this, hey, this is a great idea type thing. Educating people, spending time training them, trying to show them the value of it. And then I think the third piece is putting some metrics together to try to really encourage the use of the product that you can then see the, you know, the safety aspects or the efficiency aspects of it. And I think the real piece, I'm not sure if this was the angle or not, but you know, some people in our organization, when they hear we're becoming more efficient, we're innovating, they think job. And some people are not engaged in a way. So to me, that's the communication piece, is we've got more work to do than we'll ever get done. And I would much rather be doing some of this other work that we can't get to, showing people, you know, the value. It's, you know, about eliminating the burden or the risk. Those are my thoughts.
That's great. Thank you. You know, and being innovative and me and this tablet, there are a lot of questions here. And first of all, Ross, you're asking way too many questions.
You only get one merch item.
Oh, okay, that's fair. One of them was, yeah, one question per, no, you can ask as many questions as you want, but it doesn't mean that you get more swag. You hear that, Ross? I'm looking at you. Got questions coming in left and right. All right. So we have a question from Louis Capone. All right. How do you, as an innovator, break through systematic or organizational boundaries to truly have impact with an idea? Do you have any success stories to share?
Start. So I think in Embark we have it a little easier. We say that we do a lot of customer service, so people come to us with a very specific problem. We need to fix this. This isn't efficient. How can we improve this process? And so it's great because we can get that immediate feedback and satisfaction from a specific group. I think the challenge we have is making it more widespread than how do we give this benefit to others. So
that question was actually for me.
For it.
Now, is it okay that she took the answer? It's for everybody. Okay. Thank you for clarifying. Lewis, do you want a mug, tote, or t-shirt?
I'll take a t-shirt.
T-shirt it is. All right. Thank you.
if I could just add.
Oh, please, and use some microphone. Come on, people.
One important aspect of that is to have a clear and compelling vision for what success is, right?
The audience is there.
But I'm talking to you. A clear and compelling vision of what success looks like and why it's important. And I think once, you know, that's when you can get people with the diverse inputs and perspectives on how to get there can come together and have a conversation, because they all want to get to the same place. But you have to first define that end game. What is it? It's like going to the moon, right, NASA? I mean, we're all going to the moon, but I'm the janitor. You heard this story this morning, and I'm still helping people go to the moon, even though I'm the janitor. So it's how do you, getting that clear and compelling vision out front in front of everybody and continuing to repeat it and use that as the basis for every conversation you have, I think helps bring people to the table and into alignment.
There are some really great questions coming in here. And I assume this is JR that I was talking to earlier today that asked a question. There you are, JR. All right, this question is for Katie. What is your strategy for overcoming cultural resistance that prevents implementing new innovations, new ways of doing things? Good luck, Katie.
Microphone.
That's a really good question.
You want to think on that for a little bit?
Maybe,
a little bit. I can give you a second to think about that. We can go back to it. But do you want a t-shirt, mug, or tote?
Two t-shirts.
No, you can only get one.
It was a very hard question. I think he gets two things.
Okay, he's getting a t-shirt. All right, we're getting to Ross's first question. I might not ask all of your questions, okay, Ross? But this is a really good one. Okay. You have to let me know which one's yours, then. That's the last one. Got it. Okay. All right. Ross Wagner, how do you think telework impacts innovation, positively or negatively? That was yours. What do you want?
I get a shirt.
All right. She wants a shirt. Everybody gets it. No, not everybody gets a shirt because they were expensive and we paid out of our own pockets for that stuff. NRC's too cheap. You know, we keep talking about, you know, rewarding innovation and change, but dang, that was expensive. but I think that's a really great question, and we'll go back to that previous one, so keep thinking. And I'm really curious for your organizations. I mean, I don't even know anything about how you're implementing telework at either one of your organizations.
Well, so when I started the Center of Excellence for Collaborative Innovation 6 years ago. I was in Denver and they were in Houston. I did not want to live in Houston. I like Colorado. And they said, well, there's this job, we think you can help them. I'm like, well, how's this gonna work? And they said, well, you'll be remote. I'm like, huh? Like, I just didn't get it. And so I was the first remote employee of our team, and nobody else on the team wanted to be remote. They didn't like it. But at the same time, these projects I was doing, I was dealing with people all over the country, Canada, in different countries besides Canada. And as the pandemic came about, NASA decided, well, you know, y'all really don't need to be at Johnson Space Center. You could be anywhere, and we'd like to take your office space. So they did. They gave us some hoteling space, and now we're all virtual. And I think everyone being used to not being in a place with others has made it more of a level playing field. And when we meet and have our video meetings with either our contractors or the participants in these challenges, I just feel like it made everybody level set, you know? Does that make sense?
Yes. Y'all have noticed my strategy. I let Christine go first. Yeah, I would say in general it helps. I think their question was, does remote work help or hurt innovation?
Yes.
Yeah, so I think in general it helps. I've been amazed just what we were able to accomplish when faced with the pandemic, that we were able to remotely work and all the technology that got developed out of that so quickly. And now at Duke Energy, we're basically in a hybrid posture. So folks come in 2 days a week. Now, if you're at a nuclear power plant, you've got to be on site to do your hands-on job.
Yep.
But that ability to work remotely, and then you think about when you want to bring people together for that innovation idea, well, you don't have to have them all in the building, in the room. You can do that over Teams or WebEx, whatever you're doing. So I think it helps that collaboration. Mm-hmm. Maybe the one area that I would think it doesn't help so much is, and it's true for other things too, is if you're not together, you're not going to schedule a Teams meeting for that hallway, break room interaction that you
have.
So there is something about having people together and talking through ideas that you may not have intentionally scheduled a remote interface for that might hurt.
Gotcha. And there is a polling question that's up. How do you think the NRC is doing with innovation? We only have 10 results total, so I guess we'll wait for that to the results to pop in for that, if you don't mind taking that poll. But how about for the NRC? How is telework impacting the work that we do?
Well, that's a loaded question. I mean, that's a huge question. I mean, so telework, the work we do, I thought it was more about innovation. And
it's all related, though. Like,
yeah, so, I mean, here's what I would say. I would say that you know, innovation, as I said earlier, is gathering ideas, you know, harvesting ideas, talking about them, assessing them, and then putting them into action. So I don't necessarily think you have to be, you know, in one particular location altogether at the same time. That being to do those things.
Yeah.
And that's, and our idea scale platform that we use enables that, certainly. That being said, there are things that I believe that, you know, particularly maybe for a real short term, hey, we got to do something by a near term date, or it's a particularly complex and challenging issue that involves lots of different disciplines. I do think there's a role for in-person interaction and you know, getting insights and information on the margins of meetings that aren't scheduled, I think is very valuable. I'll tell you, just in the last 24 hours at this event here, the number of sidebar interactions I've had,
yeah.
I mean, I've taken probably 3 pages of notes already that I didn't get the last 3 years when we were doing this virtually, so.
Oh my gosh, we have so many questions. I can't even go through them all. Go ahead, Katie.
Oh yeah, I was just gonna say that's definitely the biggest benefit of being in person is those sidebar chats. You know, when you are in a Teams meeting, you just click end and you walk away. You don't see anybody after it. So I love being in meetings and being able to talk to people after it. And I think we need to focus especially on our new hires. And you know, we talked about recruitment retention. You know, they actually, the majority of them want to show up in person. They want to meet people. They want to build and foster those relationships that we've gotten to do for years and years and years. And so I think that's, you know, part of my purpose for like coming to work is being able to interact with them.
Yeah, you're also very extroverted. So for us introverts, we're like, surprisingly, I am an introvert. After this, I'm probably going to go home and take a nap. You know, you can only do so much. Going back to that other question, do you have an answer now?
Yeah, so, so I mean, you pretty much nailed, I don't know, do you want to repeat the question in case people forgot it? But
is it the resistance? Yep. What is your strategy for overcoming cultural resistance that prevents implementing new innovations, new ways of doing things?
Yeah, so that's basically you just nailed the biggest challenge that we have. People can become very complacent. They get comfortable. Change is hard. So I think for us, it really does go back to that integrated change. You know, I think people, when you just change, there's so much burnout. People don't trust. Like, they start to lose trust in our ability to change. So it's having that incremental change, baby steps. We don't have to just, you know, bombard people with a final shiny product. Like, just, you know, along the way, keep people informed what we're doing, and then hopefully, yeah, we'll all get there, and incrementally, we won't even realize that we've changed. So, and the NRC is, we are more reactive when it comes to change generally, but I think I've seen a lot of strides in us becoming more proactive to change, and I'm excited for what we've got coming in the future. So,
all right. So I'm trying to make sure that we get equal representation, because really,
can't say anything in a while.
let's just get Christine to keep talking. Okay, can we post the results of the poll? Okay. Might as well, okay. Not that many people said great. I actually agree with that. I think we could be doing better. Oh, no. Oh, no, Audrey. So many questions.
Yeah.
How much time do we have left? Yeah. Oh, gosh, 45 minutes. We don't have enough time for all of these questions. All right. This question is, I think that it's good for everybody here at the table. Or tables. Understanding the average age in the NRC and the U.S. nuclear industry is nearing retirement age. How can you incentivize accepting and embracing change among longtime employees who just want to come in, do their job, and go home? And you can just give them a t-shirt, tote, or mug at the end if they don't want to raise their hand.
Well, I'll just start. If I could, this starts with, I think, senior leadership, and you know, I myself am been eligible to retire for a couple of years now.
Ooh.
I'm very excited about the future. I mean, we heard some. I mean, if you sat through any of the plenary sessions, you know, there's a lot on our plate. It's an exciting time. We're at an inflection point, I think, in the history of the industry, and certainly how it's regulated. So, I think there is a compelling reason to change, and I think we. It starts with people like me and the EDO and others to continue to talk about that and to create a compelling reason and for why we need to change, why we need to do things differently than we've done them in the past, and actually exhibit through our own actions and words what we're willing to actually do and commit to and actually implement. At this level, so that you begin to inspire the next level, and inspire the next level, and inspire the next level. So.
Okay.
Are you smirking at my answer or the question?
No. Somebody ended up writing a comment in here, and they laughed and said, "I asked the first question and didn't get swag." Mod, do you want your swag? Where are you? Oh wait, if you're online, then you can't get swag. You got to be here in person, people. Oh, it was a handwritten card, wasn't it? I don't know where it is. I've got a stack of cards here. Papers everywhere. All right, you want to?
Yeah, I was going to add on. So I think the question was the more senior people, if that's the right word, and what are we doing to encourage or work with those folks? Is that the gist of the question?
I mean, I can repeat it.
Okay, that's what I remember. That's what I'm going to talk about then.
So you can, we'll make it up as we go. That's exactly what we're doing here.
So when, you know, I would say that people are excited, and some of the more senior folks are the biggest innovators that we have. And I look at our fleet innovation team, I would characterize those folks as more senior than less senior people. And, you know, I think many of us are so committed to the industry and you know, see the future and are wanting to make sure that they leave, you know, legacy, or they've experienced all these problems and now an opportunity to really address some of the issues and be more innovative. It's a different skill sets, different mindsets in places. So maybe it's taking those folks that, maybe have the newer technology and the newer training and the newer tools, and then the people who really have done the work for a long time. Because you can have all the technology you want, but if you don't really fix your process, then you've got to figure out how to merge those two things to make effective innovation in my mind.
So I'm going to answer this from a Stellar Solutions perspective, not really a NASA perspective. So, what drives people to be in Stellar Solutions? And I've been here for 15 years. I just got my anniversary gift. It was a rocket ship clock. It was pretty cool.
Oh, dang it.
I was excited to take that
Scott.
Through security. Yes, step it up, Scott.
Yeah, we don't do that.
But at our company, we don't talk about what we do, because what we do is provide expertise, usually seasoned expertise is the word I'm going to use. Because somehow Scott and I got old. I don't know what happened.
I don't think I'm supposed to laugh at that.
But our why is, and what we're trying to do, is solve our customers' most critical needs and at the same time put people in their dream jobs. So they're not just coming in, doing their 8 hours, and checking out, because that's not a win-win for either side. And so we're constantly, I don't want to say polling, we're constantly checking in. Like, I've got just a handful of people that work for me, and I'm constantly checking in saying, how are things going? Are you in your dream job? No. Well, why not? How can I help you get there? Do you need training? Do you need a new project? And so getting people to be a part of their dream job, understand what their dream job is, be active in working towards the dream job is really key. And then once you get there, you're gonna knock it out of the park because you're in your dream job. That's all.
Yeah, and I would just add, in any situation where there's a change, right, there's always gonna be people who are probably in one of three categories, right? They're early adopters, they love it, they want to be involved and engage. We need to find out who those are, those people are, and engage them right away. Then there's going to be folks at the other end of the spectrum where there's no way, I'm not going to do it, I'm not doing it. Then you've got the wait and seers, right? And
yeah.
So you get the early adopters engaged, and again, you keep talking about the end game and the overall vision, and then you've got to bridge, ideally continue to work it to bring in the wait and seers into the conversation and into the action. And again, you can do that through a variety of ways, recognition, etc. And then over time you reach a critical tipping point, I think, where you can actually make things really happen. So but you got to recognize that there's always going to be people in those three categories. So.
Yeah.
It reminds me of that popular video of the first follower. It's just as important as the leader. If you haven't seen it, YouTube it. It's a great video.
Is that the dancing guy?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well,
I'll send it to you.
Yeah. So he might have been under the influence of some.
That's okay.
To each their own. I've got some jokesters here. How does it, there's a question for me in here. How does it feel to be super awesome?
Tell us, please.
I don't know. It feels pretty good, man. I'm trying here. Trying to make change one step at a time. Okay. You know what we're going to do right now? Have you asked a question? If you have asked a question on a card, raise your hand. And you have not received swag. Okay, you're gonna indicate to Audrey what you want. Yeah, Greg Goff right there. He's like, I want my T-shirt. No, what do you want?
These totes, though, I don't.
Yeah, these totes are actually pretty.
I like
awesome.
The mug.
So just give everyone in the audience that's asked a question a piece of swag, because I've got too many questions to even go through. But there is this really one I mean, they're all really great, but we're let's get into the technical stuff a little bit. Let's ask the next polling question. We might as well. We got some results so far. All right, what creative solutions are the NRC considering to facilitate operator licensing on SMRs prior to widespread commercial implementation, i.e. prior to the availability of facilities on which to train? And then, so I'd like you guys to think about that for your respects. Like,
I
how do you
to answer that?
You can't answer that in respect of SMRs and such, but, you know, NASA's got a lot of innovations happening, and, you know, maybe think from your perspective, and then your perspective as well, Sean.
Sure.
So obviously it's a very specific NRC question, but I like involvement from all.
I actually don't have the answer to that. It's a great question. Thanks for asking. I mean, it's just one of so many different areas that you know, as we look to the future and even in the present with digital upgrades and digital control rooms, and it's and you know, the workforce, and you know, and the newer generations that are joining the workforce and what motivates and compels them. So I don't have an answer, but I know it is a challenge that we're ultimately going to have to face. There's just so many things in motion right now, but you know, ultimately we need high quality individuals operating these facilities, and it's we don't want to be the reason that it's an overly burdensome job. So we need to think about how to.
Get the
minimum required for safety in place, but still, you know, make it fun, if that makes sense.
Yeah, for a utility, I would say things like simulators, whether glass top or rooms, you know, the vendor who built a recently started plant had a control room simulator for years before the plant was built. And there's this term called digital twins. Mm-hmm. That doesn't resonate with me, but what it means to me is you set that digital simulator up, that tabletop, that mock-up, and then you're able to make changes to it that will model what the plant would do before you ever do it to the plant. So I can't answer the NRC version of that.
Of course, yeah.
But that would be the kind of thing that we're doing and looking at.
Microphone.
That we're doing or looking at.
Thank you. And NASA's just always doing cool things. I mean,
well,
I feel like we can't compete with NASA.
No. I mean, not all the smart people work at NASA. Not all the smart people work at the NRC, and we recognize that. And that's why we do these crowd challenges.
I think I'm pretty smart.
Well, I'm just saying it's a well-known fact, and we recognize that. And so when we look at what we're doing now, you can look at it on a you know, project execution scale of I've done this one project, I've done this other one, I've learned, I've had people participate with these different skills. Well, think about if we conglomerate all that and we now are building a larger and larger curated crowd that's solved challenges for not just NASA, but for NRC and NIH. And all that talent comes to bear. So when NASA has a hard problem, we can reach out to that huge populace and talk about leveling the playing field. I mean, everyone's included, right?
Yeah, yep. I got a question for Scott Morris. Did you shave your beard just for the Rick?
Do you want the real answer or do you want the politically correct?
No, I want the real answer.
Romantic life was suffering.
Why am I not surprised by that answer?
Okay, well, that's fair. All right, so it's not just for the Rick.
Didn't expect that.
Going back to creative solutions, I'll try to get us back on track. But what we did have, I was on a really exciting phone call yesterday looking into virtual reality options for training, for inspections. So the NRC is also involved in these types of conversations, and hopefully we'll be looking into using tools like that.
I have a comment for AV. This W12 feed for the TAYtalks is a mess. Keeps dropping and switching to other past videos. Last one was Caputo's talk. Is AV back there? They're working on it? Okay, cool.
When you say AV, I think of a different AV.
Oh, Andrea Bell? Like, yeah. AV, AK. Who, are either one of them here? We're working on it. Okay. All right, got it. Let's see what else we have in here, because we do have some interesting questions. Can't hear Scott or Katie. Yeah, no, I know there's a lot at the top. I'm trying to get to the funny ones, too. Okay. Yeah, just make sure you use your mics, people. Okay. Question for Sean Gibby. Actually, we have a few for Sean. How was Duke's innovation initiative initially received by the workers at the deck plate level? If not well received, how has your team enabled the workforce to get engaged? Ooh.
That is so easy, I'll let the NASA person answer.
I knew he was going to do that.
I think some of the things I talked about earlier is, trying to find early adopters. I like the thought of first followers, too. Trying to engage people, the end users that would have the ideas that needed. Trying to build a culture around it, so, changing on purpose, our vision, mission, and strategy to talk about transform. Taking advantage of projects, we had reasons that we wanted to put, we needed to put fiber, internet, Wi-Fi throughout our buildings. And then now that you have that infrastructure, well, what could you use with that? And so getting people engaged in thoughts like that were some of my initial thoughts.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you. Is Jonathan Evans in the audience, or are you online? Oh, there you are, Jonathan. What's up, buddy? Him and I used to be roomies back in the day. No cheering, okay. He's a good guy. I know when we were... he still is. Yeah, yeah. See, even Scott knows. Shout out. All right, I know when you're trying new things, it's hard to tell the good ideas from the bad ones beforehand. What is the most effective process for identifying the most promising ones without discouraging raw ideas? Now, did you actually mean for this question to be for me or for all of the panelists?
For all of them.
Where's your swag? You didn't raise your hand, John.
Mug.
Are there any mugs left?
Good choice.
Fantastic. You can never have enough coffee. Never enough. Or tea. Or water. Water's also good. Go ahead.
I think that our platform for idea scale helps. People can vote on the ideas. Again, going back to the challenge we've got upcoming, we're going to be directly engaging the staff to try to figure out what ideas are more popular and then start with those first. You never want to discourage people from putting in ideas.
Could you repeat the question?
Yeah, absolutely. I know when we were trying new things, it's hard to tell the good ideas from the bad ones beforehand. What is the most effective process for identifying the most promising ones without discouraging raw ideas?
I actually have an example.
Oh!
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
Oh, yeah. But it's NASA. So, once again, it's probably a good example.
I don't know. We wanted to run a NASA competition. When astronauts are in space for maybe a couple weeks at a time and they can't get out of their spacesuit, bodily functions happen, and you want to take it away from the astronauts. And so
I read about this recently.
Yeah, so we had, well, we
this,
had
this
to,
was in the news.
And we had the first competition, and we had a very long name for it when NASA, it was like this long. And we hired a company called HeroX to run the project for us. And without getting NASA approval, they decide to call it Space Poop. Okay? And with a name like that, it went viral. It got on Trevor Noah's show. And we're running this competition, and we suddenly had thousands of submissions. And we were not equipped to review thousands of submissions. And luckily, the contractor was nice enough to screen through those. So you've got to have, qualifications by which ideas have to meet certain things. And going through those, we were able to screen out thousands of submissions that NASA did not need to look at. There's also Lunar Loo.
Space poo and Lunar Loo.
Space toilet.
Yeah, I would have just said the same process, although we're not dealing with thousands of ideas, but, having some criteria and then engaging multiple levels of the organization, once you kind of vet out what multiple people can weigh in on the criteria, and then, you just work through the process, okay, what's the value of this innovation, and seek some alignment, and then recognize people who are offering suggestions and without discouraging.
And in those things you're scoring solutions against, you need to understand what's of most importance to you. Is it the idea is innovative? Is it the idea is achievable in a certain amount of time? All of those things, and you may need to bring in subject matter experts to help you figure that out.
Okay. All right. There are just so many good questions. Did you want to say something, Scott? Are you sure?
I want to say something.
Yeah.
I'm going to wait for your question.
Oh, okay. All right. How about this one? And this is for everybody as well. Speak to your younger self. What can you do to be a change maker? Young people may be scared to shake things up, unlike Taylor Hart. I'm not that young, but I appreciate that. You must be an NRANer. Kelly, where's Kelly? Hi, Kelly. Did you get your swag? Fantastic.
So I'll start. So
please do. I want to hear more.
I have an example too. So part of it is just getting out and talk. Don't sit in your office and wait for people to come to you. Is get out and talk to people, right? So I make it a point to get out of my office and actually go out and talk to people where they are. So and actually elicit ideas. And then when I'm in a meeting, and there's we're having a discussion about some topic, and I'll take note of who's talking, who's adding, and who's just kind of sitting and listening, and I'll make it a point to call out people who haven't said anything, right? Because I've seen in my experience, some of the best ideas come from people who maybe just lack the courage or the confidence to engage in those types of venues. But it's creating a safe space for people to bring ideas out into the open. We had a case. And then if ideas don't work or things get implemented, just being available for people to provide feedback. I'll give you a quick example. We did an active shooter drill in Region 4 where I was, and it was live. We had real police in with real guns firing blanks. And
okay, I was gonna say not real ammo. Come
no,
on.
No. But
I'm really
but,
scared.
But, and we learned a lot of lessons from that. And if you know anything about if you've ever had training on active shooter, the concept is run, hide, or fight, right?
Yeah.
In that order. And so if you have to hide, we were telling people to hide in their offices and close the door. Well, the doors don't have locks, right? So somebody had an idea to let's buy rubber doorstops and give everybody a rubber doorstop so they can jam it under their door from the inside.
Solution.
Right? So we did that and we bought everybody got everybody a doorstop. And then one day, I wasn't the regional administrator at the time, but one of our very young, newer staff came in, just barged right into the regional administrator's office and said, "This is a great idea, but it really sucks." And he said he took the doorstop, he closed the door of the regional administrator's office, he stuffed this thing under, and he just pushed it. It didn't, because the carpet and the rubber, it didn't it was not enough friction to stop the door. So, but instead of being appalled, you know, the regional administrator was like, wow, I'm so glad you came in and we'd had this demonstration and you felt the courage to come in here and, you know, jump seven levels of management. And so to create that environment, but to create that environment where that's okay, you know?
I think that's one thing that the NRC does pretty well. And, you know, we've got a group of, you know, I use the acronym NRANners, but the Nuclear Regulator Apprenticeship Network? Yeah, regulator. Sometimes I say regulatory, but tomato, tomato. But, you know, they are shaking things up and people are listening to, you know, this new generation of folks that are coming in. And I think we're doing a really great job with hiring. I'm not going to lie to you. I work with some pretty awesome people. Shout out to Tommy Hayden, if you're listening to this right now, and my branch. He's just like really helping me shake some things up related to data. And, you know, getting these new people in that aren't afraid to try new things is incredible. And I'm going to turn over to you because I haven't faced this way in a little bit. So if you speak into your younger self.
Yeah, I feel like we're in the same environment that I was in when I started Duke. It's exciting times for us. And so I came into Duke, I worked in fuels, nuclear fuels, and we were developing a lot of our own methods and codes, and I was a programmer, and how do you make all these reports work, and so a lot of innovation was happening, and here we are with, you know, looking at, for our current fleet, uprating, 24-month cycles, modernization of these plants, because we're going to run them through 2050, 2060 safely and reliably. There's a lot of opportunity there, so, you know, I'd say don't wait for permission. Make the job what you want it to be. You're the best innovator of where you're working now. And so, you know, take the opportunity. I think we're all open and looking for these innovative ideas. So take the opportunity to come forth and make that tool, bring that idea. That's what I would say.
Well, I'm trying to find something very interesting here. First, I was going to say, what would I tell my younger self? Don't study electrical engineering. when I got out of the program, I felt a little bit beaten down and maybe battered and not really welcomed in that program, and actually told flat out, you do not belong here, and you need to change your major. but I did.
It was a much different generation.
It was. It was. And so when I got into working for a three-letter intelligence agency, I was very quiet. I was very withdrawn until I had one person say to me, he was about my age, and, you know, he was getting all this responsibility and doing well, and he said, I don't know what happened to you, but you're just as smart as everybody else around this table. Speak up. And, you know, I thought I had a vote of confidence, and from then I didn't look back. And I guess I'd also say, you know, be brave. You never know who you're inspiring. You don't know who's watching. And maybe they need some reassurance and they can look up to you.
That was good. That was really good. You know, and this is one of those things where we're trying something new in this session that you're attending right now. How many RIC sessions have you been to where there isn't a script or a PowerPoint presentation that's filled with words? No offense to the other way of doing things, but this could very well be a failure. Somebody might say, this didn't work, we're never gonna do it again. But I'm hoping that this is going to be, you know, something that people will consider again in the future. Is this working? So I'm asking the audience, is this working? You can cheer applause if it is, and fantastic. All right, and I see NEI in the front that's not exactly, I think you're NEI, right? Is this Jim? Hi, Jim.
No, Taylor, not offended at all.
But I do know, I do have a question, because Jim actually ended up contacting me ahead of this session, and I think that this is a really important question, because we keep talking about internal crowdsourcing, changing ideas internally, or making, you know, ideas happen internally, but I think one of the things that we're not doing really great is, you know, outreach. We're not working with the industry as well as we could be. And, you know, I want to know, you know, from Sean and you know, of course, from the NRC perspective, but really, Sean, you know, what do you think we could be doing better? How would you say that we should be working with the industry to make true change happen with the nuclear industry?
Yeah, I might not be the best responder. That previous question about how well the NRC was doing, I would have gave a little higher mark than the general answer. And Jim is leading our NEI task force on innovation. So I see it's a lot of collaboration in the industry. When, you know, we have EPRI, we have NEI, we have the PWR owners group, the BWR owners group, all looking to work together. And the NRC is definitely a big part of that. I think what we see coming, we need to be maybe a little more urgent. We've got a lot of work to do to make these goals happen. You know, things like, I'm not sure you want me to get in this detail, but...
No, yeah,
but,
please do.
But building out the Wi-Fi, putting on remote monitoring of equipment, you know, on the secondary side of the plant, not safety related. And then, you know, so the next step of that is, well, how do we take all this data and failure modes and preventive maintenance bases and use machine language learning or AI to figure out how do we really get the best condition-based monitoring to make our plants the safest and reliable. And, you know, so then how do we carry that forward? One of the key efforts we're working on now with the NRC is maybe more safety or important to safety equipment. How do we monitor that and,
yep.
and cybersecurity issues? You know, the risk-informed approaches, if you've been to these other forums, there's a lot of discussion about risk-informed approaches. Those are very valuable to us. And so working mm-hmm. through those submittals, 5069, TISTIF 505, we've all got TISTIF 425. And so I'd say there is good cooperation, and it's just a matter of us realizing, you know, some of the regulatory framework and changes that we can make to speed things along, so to speak.
Yeah.
And, you know, not to throw a little bit of shade to Embark, but, you know, I used to be in Embark. Oh, I know Katie's going to comment on this. I actually used to be in Embark. That's kind of what got me really motivated with change. But, you know, when we first started Embark, there was a lot more outreach. And, you know, I'm kind of curious to know, like, should we be having biweekly meetings with the industry? What could we be doing better to make sure that we're working with the industry?
Go ahead.
So yes, definitely want to put a plug in for our mission analytics portal, external MapX. So we started this back when Taylor was in Embark, so at least 2 years ago, and we really weren't outreaching at all with the customer of this product, and that's on us. So we did meet, I guess, I don't know, maybe 2 weeks ago with Jim, with Brett from NEI. So we are starting to engage, and we're setting up focus groups with the licensee. We have our first one next week. So we are hoping to get a lot of participation in that and really look to them and say, what can you get out of this portal? What's going to make your job easier? We know what we're going to be getting out of it, but we need to make sure that this is both beneficial for the NRC and the licensee. And then also, you know, be more transparent with where we are, with the current status and what, you know, where we see this product going. And I think it'll help us be more accountable and hopefully a little quicker to get it up and running. So.
Well, I just wanted to just add that, you know, you heard it this morning about the need for more proactive engagement. Obviously, we have lots of public meetings at different levels on different topics every year. You know, perhaps there are ways we can spice those up or make them more effective and efficient through technology or what have you. And we've tried to do some of that. But I will say this, we are looking at, you know, the crowdsourcing that we do now is all for more or less internal issues and in polling the NRC staff. But we are looking to pilot something that will that's externally facing, and that's so that's coming. So
oh, that's good to know.
Yeah,
so I didn't know that.
Yeah, so
why didn't I know?
Christine might know a little something about that.
Okay,
what? I thought I knew everything. Hmm? I definitely don't know everything. How, Jim? How does that sound as a response to your question? Good. Okay, so we're going to be working with you a little bit more. It sounds like. Which I think is good. Christine, did you buy that fancy NASA shirt at the Gap?
I have been known to purchase NASA things at Target. However, I did buy this one on site at Johnson Space Center.
Okay, all right, it's legit. That is legit NASA swag. Not off the street of DC or anything like that, you know, from those random vendors that you get. Okay. How much time do we have left? We got about 10 minutes left. I'm trying to find something that's more outward facing because we definitely.
Well, I can just riff if you like.
You riff for a little bit. I got a question rolled up here.
Okay. Well, we talk a lot about innovation and crowdsourcing and prizes and challenges. And I'm sitting here thinking, well, what's the most innovative things my group has done at NASA, and it really comes down to our acquisition team and our lawyers, because, you know,
the lawyers.
Yeah, because when you're in the government, like when you're a public citizen, you say, is this illegal, right? But yeah. When you're in the government, you're like, does the law tell me to do this thing, right?
Yeah.
And then you've got all the other acquisition regulations around it, and they've found a way to be very creative and make the laws and the rules work for us. And I think that's just been a tremendous thing that allows us to do things very quickly. Like, say you came to me, or Kelly comes to me with an idea on a project, we can work out a request for task plan in a couple weeks, we can release it, and within a month, I can have a contractor on contract working with you to develop your whole challenge and run the whole thing, which, you know, with acquisition a month is ridiculous. But the way they've structured all of our contracts, they make it very doable and repeatable.
So I have a random question for the audience. How many of you have tried to use the RIC website on your mobile phone? How many of you have had success with the RIC website on your mobile device?
Yeah.
Can you scroll? Yeah. No scroll. Okay, all right, yeah, so what they're saying in the audience, you gotta like flip it and manipulate it. Yeah, I know my dad, shout out to Mitch. He's on the line right now. He was like, I can't sign up through the website. What do I do? So I had to sign him up. But, you know, these are the little things that we need to do better with. These little things will end up adding up to big things. I mean, the fact that you can't sign up for the RIC on the mobile device, I know I'm getting a lot of flack for trying to post a dashboard for use by the public on, you know, the new scale application. But I have to follow all of these rules and regulations and Digital Experiences Act, but for whatever reason, it's like it's selective. And I think consistency is key in being successful with innovation and following these rules and acts that are, you know, that we have to implement. We got a few minutes left. Let's see. What does modern risk-informed regulating mean to you?
I'll start.
I wanted to look at Christine because I knew she was going to be like, what?
Christine probably doesn't know. So that's a it's something, it's a phrase that's been sort of our rallying cry now for about 4 years, is we want to become a more modern risk-informed regulator. And that's a nice catchphrase, and it sounds good, but what does it mean?
Do you think Be Risk Smart is successful?
Are we talking about modern risk-informed or being risk-smart? We can go either way.
Let's go bold.
Okay, so modern risk-informed, let me just finish on that. So for me it is, and I think many of us have internalized it different ways, but when I'm asked what does it mean, what I think about is are we just doing our mission, but are we doing it in the most efficient and effective way? Obviously, we have to remain independent. Obviously, we have to be clear and transparent and ideally reliable, but are we doing it in the most efficient way? And, you know, admittedly, our agency's been slow to change and adapt to things. It's certainly in my career, it's taken sort of paradigm shifting events to get us to move, you know, in a different direction. And so this is how do we, without that paradigm shifting event, how do we continue to evolve and adapt and embrace modern ways of thinking, doing things, whether it's the use of data, whether it's using Be Risk Smart or risk information, not just in reactor related stuff, but in terms of how we do our internal business, you know, what and even in legal advice. You know, I had a conversation with Marion Zobler, our general counsel, and I asked her this question directly. I said, what is OGC doing to become a modern risk-informed regulator? Not exactly in those terms. and you know, I was surprised that there was a lot of things that they're doing internally that I didn't know about to try to enhance the speed and efficiency with which they can deliver sound advice. So that's what it means to me. It may mean other things to other people, but essentially that's what it is for me.
Yeah, I'll add to that, because definitely putting my Embark hat on, my first thought is data and using that to automate our processes, make them more efficient. So an example of that, starting last year, we put together a dashboard for all of our endocycles with the licensees. We were able to pull that data more readily, and also we have access to it throughout the whole year, which is great. But we, you know, we looked in, great thing too, when you're using data, then you can also see how efficient a process is. You can, you know, then use that data to show success. But we used about 30% less hours putting together our end of cycles just when we rolled it out last year in 2022. And then this year we saved an additional 10%. So we're already 40% down from the amount of time that was taking us to pull that data for end of cycles. So that to me was a good example of us becoming more modern and risk-informed.
And modernizing the way we share information with our stakeholders, including public, and the accessibility of data and information and analysis from our website is, if anybody's tried to find things on our website, sometimes it's a little challenging. So how do we modernize?
Once again, the website. And Sean, do you want to chime in on what that means, being a modern risk-informed regulator?
Yeah, I was listening intently. you know, to me, it's the things I mentioned, is the risk-informed decision-making is where my mind goes, and the things like TSTA 505 and 5069, you know, risk-informed categorization, treatment of structures, risk-informed completion times, this new RIPE process. We're getting ready to submit our first RIPE. And things like that, those are very helpful and, you know, again, help us assess the risk, agree together, mm-hmm. and we target the most safe, reliable aspects of what we need to work on or fix.
Okay. And with that, we only have a couple of minutes left, so I really just wanted to take time for those of you that took the risk, took your chance, did something different, and attended this RICSA. You know, this is absolutely new. I don't know how what my management is going to say to me later on, but we'll find out. But hopefully you found this to be relatively successful.
I'll calibrate them for you. I'll calibrate them for you.
Yes. I got the okay from Scott. Did you like how you didn't have to Well, it's not like you developed slides for
your
presentation.
Keep it up for me. I had to take it.
So. Yeah. Well, it's not like you have to develop slides for yourself anymore. You got people for that. So.
Like but, me, for example.
Poor Katie. But I wanted to say thanks for being here. Don't be afraid to speak up. Don't be afraid to try to do something bigger, do something better. Communicate, interact with your peers, interact with all age levels, and just do it. Don't be afraid to just make change happen.
Be the change.
Be the change, yeah. Be it. All right, and with that, thank you so much for being at this RIC session, and post the results of how we, there we go. All of these sound great. All right, with that, thank you so much, and cue up the last song of the session. Thank you, everybody.